Call this regular meeting of the Village of Villa Park Planning and Zoning Commission to order. We'll have a roll call. Rickel?
Yes.
Commissioner Bello?
Yes.
Commissioner Jarrett?
Here.
Commissioner Lowski?
Yes.
Commissioner Gatto?
Here.
We have a quorum. First agenda item is approval of minutes from February 9th, 2017, and Commissioner Hassler just joined us as well. I was saying that the first agenda item is approval of minutes for February 9th, 2017. Is there a motion to approve?
I'd make a motion to approve the minutes of February 9th, 2017.
I'll second that motion.
Second, thank you. Any questions or comments? Vote by roll call. Commissioner Rickel?
Yes.
Bello?
Abstain.
Jarrett?
Yes.
Orlowski?
Yes.
Gatto?
Yes.
Hassler?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Thank you. We have a number of public hearings this evening. I know that's why you're all here this evening. We're going to start with petition PZ 170005, continuation for the special use of a private school on the Jewel Osco property at 29 East St. Charles Road. Petitioner is Jeff Jenner of Chicagoland Academy. Since this is a continued hearing, I want to start by asking, reminding you that you were sworn in if you were here last time. Is there anyone else from the petitioner's side wishing to speak tonight that wasn't sworn in previously? No? Okay. Everyone else has been sworn in. Okay. So then we're going to go ahead and start that. We'll start with, we'll go back in the order of the agenda, which is we'll start with any new information the petitioner would like to provide. Then we're going to see if there's any additional staff input, and then we'll open up for public participation and questions. So whoever would like to come forward and begin the presentation, please again, though, for all of us, state your name for the record.
Jeff Jenner. Just go to the one slide. Well, while they're doing that, I think where we left it last, we were here a couple months ago and asked to go see traffic safety and work out a solution with them that would address some of your concerns with just safety of children, parents walking from the parking lot to the school, back and forth. And I believe you do have the recommendations from the city engineer. If you don't, I have copies. I can certainly give those to you. But so we're all, you know, we forward those recommendations on to the landlord, who will go ahead and, you know, everything's approved. Eventually, they'll do that work, set up the signs, provide the crosswalk. I think there's also a accessible handicap parking space they want right in front. And then there's a crosswalk that would connect the handicap parking space to the front of the school. Okay. And I wish I could show you the image. We did a little sketch, and
that's what you're trying to show on the computer?
Yeah, I guess we're having a problem getting it up. But the written description of the work that is being proposed, I believe you have. So that's one thing. And the other thing that was discussed was the garden center that is there right now. That's there for, I'm not sure, maybe one month a year in spring. And maybe that, you know, positioning that in such a way so it has lesser of an impact on the school parking or the future school parking. And I mean, if you go out there now, you could see it's parked over to the side. And I think it would allow enough parking spaces for the school, because there's a lot of coming and going, and we don't really need a lot of parking. So, I'm sorry, I wish you had the image, but it looks like we're having some technical difficulties. So,
but basically what you're indicating, I think there's one, two, three, four, five bullet points that were recommendations of the Traffic and Safety Committee. And that you're indicating that between you and the landlord, all those recommendations will be incorporated into the design of the school.
That's right.
Okay. Okay.
So I guess that's really that's all we really have right now. That's
okay.
New.
That's new.
And,
okay.
Anyone else can talk.
Okay, thank you. Director Grill, is there anything that you want to add?
Staff did have a recommendation on some of the improvements to be made to the school, and that was included in the recommendation that was made to the Traffic and Safety. Well, actually, it was originally made to the Planning and Zoning Commission. Same recommendation was made to the Traffic and Safety. Traffic and Safety did hear this and voted to concur with staff's recommendation.
Okay.
Nothing else has changed as part of the request. And therefore, if the commission were willing to make a motion to approve, staff did put together what a motion could look like. And basically, it'd be a special use pursuant to Section 610A20 for a private school. For the property located at 29 East St. Charles Road, PIN number 0610-100-019, with the following conditions: that the appropriate permits are obtained for any interior modifications, that necessary fire and building inspections are completed prior to occupancy, and that a handicap space, crosswalk, and signage be added as recommended by staff with concurrence of the Traffic and Safety Committee, with a finding of fact that was included in the staff memo originally dated
January 13th,
2017, that such special use meets the standards enumerated in Article 610D of Appendix C of the Municipal Code of the Village of Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance. And with that, I'll answer any questions that the commission might have.
Would you think that we would need to read?
Yeah,
I see that it's a summary sort of that we've added into the recommendation. Do you think we need to read the five bullet points, or is it enough to refer to the Traffic and Safety's concurrence and the staff memo?
It certainly wouldn't hurt to include those bullet points.
Since we don't have a drawing as an exhibit?
Correct.
That might be the way we overcome the drawing situation, okay? Just to make sure that everyone is on the same page. Great. Okay, thank you. We're gonna move into public participation and questions. Is there any one member of the public that wishes to speak in regard to this petition and the information provided this evening? I'm seeing no one, so we'll move on here. to questions from commission members. Any commissioner members with further questions?
I have a quick question. This is a question I asked last time. With this school being there, does Ardmore Avenue become a school zone, and should it become a school zone with school signs and 20 miles an hour when students are present?
No. Both the public works staff and traffic and safety discussed that very topic and said, no, this is not a school zone worthy of signage along Ardmore Avenue.
How's that determined then? Number of students, square footage of the building?
Unfortunately, you're asking the wrong guy.
Yeah, and it's above our pay grade, so.
I thought he might know.
It's a great, it's an excellent question.
You can't dance unless you ask.
Yeah, you can't dance.
I wish I knew everything, but I don't.
Okay. No, you look like you know everything.
Excellent question.
He gave the response of that the appropriate people addressed it, so there's not much more we can do, but I appreciate the question. Any other questions by commission member?
No, all my questions have been answered.
Okay, great. And I'm going to tend to kind of move these things along tonight because you all don't want to be here till midnight, neither do we. So, all right. Any closing comments you'd like to make, Mr. Jenner?
Sure. I'll just make a quick comment. We're looking forward to being here in Middle Park.
Okay.
To be here.
Thank you.
Thank
you for the precision. Thank you. All right. So we're going to close the public hearing unless there's anyone else that wants to speak. Seeing none, discussion by commission members, if any, otherwise a motion.
I think we had concerns regarding the pedestrian traffic and that being the main ingress and egress of the mall there, and it looks like they've taken that to heart and made a lot of recommendations.
Yeah, the recommendations about the no stopping, standing parking signs in front, because I can see that being a problem with the quick drop off, you know, with schools and daycares, how that goes. I think the addition of a handicapped spot, which I think was recommended by traffic and safety, was good because there is not one at that end of the shopping center, as far as I know. So I think with this review, I'm much more comfortable with this than I was 2 months ago.
Agreed.
Commissioner Jackson just joined us at 8:15. All right. I agree too. I think that the use in that location is a good use. And it seems like the traffic and safety, you guys did a good job of requesting this information at the last time that they were here presenting. And I think traffic and safety did a good job. I just think we should read this in to a motion because there's some detail here I want to make sure it gets captured when it goes to the board, and certainly when staff has it to review when it comes in as permits for achieving this work in the field. So with that, we could have a motion.
Now I'll make a motion to approve application PZ170005 for the following. One, special use pursuant to section 6.10.A.20 for a private school for a property located at 29 East St. Charles Avenue, PIN 06101000019, with the following conditions: that appropriate permits are obtained for any interior modifications. Two, that any necessary fire and building inspections are completed prior to occupancy. Three, a crosswalk would need to be striped across the drive aisle near the entrance of the building. Four, a handicap parking space would need to be located in the parking space nearest the entrance of the school. The parking space and access route would need to meet all current ADA standards. This would include, but is not limited to, size and slopes. Five, signs will need to be posted in front of the school stating no stopping, standing, parking. These signs will need to be installed the length of the school. Six, typical school warning crosswalk signs would need to be installed. Seven, documentation showing the discussions between the school and the landlord have been had as to where both employees and parents will be allowed to park. If signage is to be installed restricting parking for this purpose, we would need to know where, at, and how much. with the finding of fact that such special use meets the standards enumerated in Article 6.10. D of Appendix C of the Municipal Code, Village of Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance.
Okay, thank you. I have a motion as read. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Second on the motion. Any questions or comments on the motion?
I think we need to amend the motion to include the passage here. Additionally, the school will not be allowed to have a stop sign installed in the drive aisle as the proximity of the parking lot enters the school at Ardmore Avenue would create traffic issues.
Okay. Commissioner Hassler, do you want
to? I'd like to amend my motion to include item number 8.
Okay, so.
Do I need to reread it?
Yeah, we need to withdraw the second.
Withdraw the second.
Okay. So. Go ahead, amend your motion.
I'd like to amend my motion to include item number 8. Additionally, the school will not be allowed to have a stop sign installed in the drive aisle as the proximity of the parking lot entrance to the school and Ardmore Avenue would create traffic issues.
Okay. Thank you. Revised, amended motion. Do we have a second on the amended motion?
Second that.
Second. Any other additional questions or comments? If not, we'll vote by roll call. Commissioner Rickel?
Yes.
Bello?
Yes.
Jarrett?
Yes.
Orlowski?
Yes.
Gatto?
Yes.
Hassler?
Yes.
And I too vote yes. Mr. Jackson, I skipped you just because you
abstained.
Yes, thank you. So with that, our recommendation passes to the Village Board. They can either accept, reject, or modify our recommendation. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so we're going to move on to the second hearing for this evening, which is petition PZ 17-0008, variance from required front yard setback from 40 feet to 36.3 feet, variance from maximum street facing garage from 21 feet to 22 feet, variance to exceed maximum lot coverage from 30% to 33%, and variance to required rear yard setback from 40 feet to 37.6 feet for property located at 220 West Jackson Street. The petitioner is Robin L. Petrolli. Was I close?
Petrolia.
Petrolia. Okay, so I was close. I was in the ballpark.
That's very good.
So, sir, I'm going to need you to be sworn in first. And then after you're sworn in, state your name and address for the record, and then you may present your case. So.
My name is Rob Petrolia. I currently reside at 32 Windsor Drive in Elmhurst. And I'm here before you tonight because my wife and I have purchased the lot at 220 West Jackson. We purchased that lot out of foreclosure from a bank. And our intentions are to remove the house, tear down the house that's there, and build a new home for the two of us. Our intentions for that home was to serve us into our retirement years. We currently have a larger house in Elmhurst. We would like to have a home in Villa Park with a bedroom on the first floor. It would in many ways be a condominium, but on a single family lot. The second story just has two bedrooms. One of our desires in acquiring the lot, not only, but in planning and designing the home on the lot, was to fit into the character of our neighbors. We are friends with the neighbors immediately to the east who have a full two-story house. We've gotten to know the folks just to the west of us who have a single-story home. And so what we have are proposing is a two-story home, but really a story and a half in a sense, so that in some ways we can be part of transitioning the home sizes there. We are very excited to be a part of Villa Park. 43 years ago, my wife and I rented a home here. We have been in Lombard, in Elmhurst, and now we've come full circle to be back in Villa Park. The variances that we're requesting really relate to the size of the lot. It is in R2 designation, which typically would be a 7,500 square foot lot minimum. These lots were all platted in the 7,100 plus range, and in so doing, the dimensions of the lot makes it difficult to achieve what we are hoping to with the home that we're planning. In particular, the coverage ratio, we exceed that given the lot size. And then the setbacks that I know are before you in terms of the information you've received are such that we are not able to fit a bedroom on the first floor as well as the other uses that we typically would experience on the first floor. And so for those reasons, we've requested the variances that you have before you. And we look forward to your favorable ruling on that. Thank you.
So that's a presentation of the petitioner, staff input. Director Grill.
Mr. Petrolia did a very good job of outlining his request and the reasons why he needs this variation. In looking at the area, the specific variances being requested are not necessarily out of line when you have a smaller lot that doesn't meet the minimum lot requirements of the zoning district in which it is located. The specific property has a what staff would consider a problem house on it. It has had numerous code enforcement issues over the last several years that we've been dealing with, and we're very pleased that somebody has stepped forward and is going to improve the neighborhood. The request for the type of home, which is just a three-bedroom home, is also not out of character with the given area. It's not your what some people refer to as a McMansion being built on a small lot. I think the petitioner has done a good job of trying to maintain the character of the area. With that given, staff wishes to notice that this public hearing was properly published in the Daily Herald on March 27th. And if the commission finds in support of the applicant's request, the following motion could be entertained: to approve application PZ 17008 for request and include a variation to the required front yard setback along Jackson Street from 40 feet to 36.3 feet for purposes of constructing a new single family structure at 220 West Jackson, a variation from the maximum street facing garage width from 21 to 22 feet, a variation from the maximum lot coverage from 30% to 33%, and for a variation to the minimum required rear yard setback from 40 feet to 37.6 feet with the following conditions: that the new single family structure be located as shown on the proposed site plan as prepared by V3 and dated March 9th, 2017, that the elevation of the new single family structure be as shown on sheet A3A prepared by BLR Architects and dated February 12th, 2017, with a finding of fact as included in the staff memo dated March 31st, 2017, that such variation meets the standards enumerated in Article 6.7.B of Appendix C of the Municipal Code of the Village of Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance. With that, I'll entertain any questions the commission might have.
Are there any members of the public wishing to speak in regards to this petition? I see no one interested in speaking. So we're going to move on to questions from commission members. Commissioners.
I just two things. One was that were brought up, I guess the question is, it's a concern. One is the lot coverage and water runoff, and is this going to affect the neighbor's property? I guess it would be a concern of mine.
Let's take that one first. Stormwater is the question.
Preliminary review by the engineering department indicated there won't be any particular stormwater problems associated with this new home being constructed, mm-hmm. but obviously we have codes in place that prohibit any more runoff from the site than what currently exists, and staff will ensure that those requirements are met.
Yeah, he'll have to submit engineering plans.
Okay.
It'll be a requirement.
I say a properly graded lot that probably wasn't graded well at all.
To begin with.
70 years ago. Yeah. Will be a vast improvement, I'm sure.
All right. Okay.
May I just answer the question?
Sure,
well?
Sure.
My profession is civil engineering.
Okay.
I am the founder and president of B3 Companies, and so our business is in drainage and roads and streets. If my backyard doesn't drain properly and side yards, I will have a lot of unhappy employees who are going to say, are you embarrassing us in this way?
Yeah.
I've talked with engineering. We actually, it's an existing problem in the rear yard today. And knowing the neighbor on the east side, what I intend to do is to actually connect to the storm sewer system with a rear yard drain so that we can actually correct a problem.
Yeah.
And as it relates to the permissible total lot coverage or the impervious surface coverage, we are, I think, like 25%. Below the maximum allowable impervious area. So we've tried to respect that as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And then I guess the other thing is, and this is just, I guess, more of a, you know, the rule here is, you know, is it, I guess, saying that, you know, he's built these plans for this house, which I'm excited to see.
Mm-hmm.
But the size of the house is a little larger than the lot fits. Is that really a hardship or
well,
not? That's the.
I think to me something that wasn't presented. It's not only a small lot. It's a trapezoidal lot.
Right.
So
I noticed that too.
So part of the difficulty with putting a orthogonal house on there, you know, that has 490 degrees the corners to it, is that you can't necessarily align. I appreciated that the petitioner gave us floor plans, and I looked through the sizes of the room and the garage, and there's nothing super huge there. They're reasonable spaces, but there's not excessive space, and I think that's what Director Grill was trying mm-hmm. to say. This isn't a McMansion or an inflated size house. This is the kind of size house that you would expect to see.
Mm-hmm.
So I really do, you know, you can't make your own hardship. The lot is below ordinance already, but it's platted, and it's a zoning lot of record, a legal lot, and it's an odd shape. Two things that this petitioner didn't create. It seems to me like it's a classic case of trying to do the best that someone can, respecting the neighborhood, and I do appreciate the architect and the owner looking to blend in between the two houses. That, to me, I think they've kind of done the best they can. That's my feeling on it, given the geometry and everything else. If this would have had a giant, you know, family room off the back that was, you know, I would feel differently. But
yeah, and the variances don't seem.
And I went to my comments already, but
no, but I mean, yeah, and the variances aren't great in measure compared to the other homes in the area.
Yeah,
I understand.
And I think you can see on the picture and then even on the plat, the zoning plat here, they've tried to indicate the other neighboring properties. Everyone, you've sort of got this jigsaw effect because the road isn't parallel with the front of the houses.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think this is going to seem out of place. I don't know. And I'm jumping into opinions, but that's my answer to your question.
I appreciate your answer.
Any other questions? Okay. Any closing comments you'd like to make, sir?
Probably the most important one is that this puts us within a block of our grandchildren.
There you go.
and so in part, that's how we heard about the lot. But no, we're just very pleased to be able to be back in Villa Park and look forward to being contributing to the village in every way that we can as well. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. There aren't any other comments by the public, which I'm seeing none. We're going to go into, we're going to close the public hearing and any discussion by commission members.
I've looked over this pretty closely, and it is a smaller lot, and the house is reasonably sized, especially compared to neighbors. You pointed out the trapezoidal lot causes some issues. I drive past this existing house every morning, dropping my son off at school, and there's not a house on that street that stands out more than this house, the existing house that's there, and it doesn't stand out in the way that is positive. Not just maintenance, it's a very strange design. But personally, I like this, what I see here. I'm comfortable with this.
Any other comments?
Happy to see it.
Happy to see it. It seems to be the consensus is that everyone seems to be very happy with what they see here. And we do appreciate the thought that went into trying to fit in and dealing with the lot. So I want to state that again. I can tell that there's been some thought put into the design and being appropriate for the neighborhood and the lot, and we appreciate that. So having said that, we could have a motion.
I would make a motion to approve application PZ170008 for requests that include, one, a variation of the required front yard setback along Jackson Street from 40 feet to 36.3 feet for purposes of constructing a new single-family structure at 220 West Jackson Street. Two, a variation from the maximum street-facing garage width from 21 feet to 22 feet. Three, a variation from the maximum lot coverage from 30% to 33%. Four, a variation from the minimum required rear yard setback from 40 feet to 37.6 feet with the following conditions. One, that the new single family structure be located as shown on the proposed site plan as prepared by V3 and dated March 9th, 2017. Two, that the elevation of the new single family structure be as shown on sheet A3A prepared by BLR Architects and dated February 12th, 2017. With findings, a finding of fact that such variations meet the standards enumerated in Article 6.7b of Appendix C of the Municipal Code, Village of Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance, with finding of facts as stated in the memorandum dated March 30th, 2017.
Thank you. Motion, is there a second?
Second that motion.
Second on the motion. Any questions or comment on the motion as read? No questions or comment. Vote by roll call. Commissioner Rickel?
Yes.
Commissioner Bello?
Yes.
Commissioner Jarrett?
Yes.
Commissioner Orlowski?
Yes.
Commissioner Gatto?
Yes.
Hassler?
Yes.
Jackson?
Yes.
And I too vote yes. With this, our recommendation goes to the Village Board. They can either accept, reject, or modify our recommendation. Thank you.
Deck so I can see the next thing.
Use this company.
Okay, we're going to keep moving here. Appreciate everybody else's patience here as we get through this agenda. Petition PZ170009, variance from required rear yard setback from 40 feet to 12.2 for construction of an attached garage and for a corner side yard setback from 20 feet to 10 feet for construction of a covered front patio for property located at 803 South Wisconsin Avenue. Petitioner is Thomas Knapp. Is there someone representing the petitioner here?
Yeah, great.
So, sir, it'll be the same thing as the previous petitioner. We'll need you to be sworn in, and then you'll state your name and your address for the record, and then you may proceed.
I do.
Thank you.
My name is Tom Knapp. I'm the architect for the Doug and Sue Holler. Doug and Sue called me because they recently purchased a home, which is a one-story ranch home with a one-car garage. And when they bought the home, the previous owner had done some work on the inside of the home where they had expanded their kitchen into the existing one-car garage. The existing one-car garage was made smaller in a way that they cannot park a vehicle in their one-car garage at this time. They asked me if I could find a way to add the one-story addition for a two-car garage, and they understood that there was no room in the rear yard in order to allow that garage on the addition. So their primary goal of the project is the two-car garage so that they can put their two vehicles in the new garage. And they plan on using the existing parking area or the existing interior garage space, which is not big enough for a garage, they're going to use that as storage and shop area for a small wood shop for the family. When they asked me about it and I looked into it, I confirmed that yes, they needed the variance for the rear yard. I also asked them if they wanted to do any kind of exterior improvements in order to make the home look better from the street. And one thing that they did tell me is that they did not have any exterior space for entertaining in their yard. They do have grandchildren, and they were hoping that they could have some kind of an outdoor space where they could have a dining area. I recommended to them that they do the open brick patio in the front. And when we started talking about it, they did ask that we add the roof in order to have a covered entry and have a covered dining area. The way that it's presented to you right now, when I looked at zoning, I needed to have the corner side yard setback reduced, not for the patio itself, but for the roof above the patio. And I instructed them that they would need the variance for both the side yard, the corner side yard, and the rear yard. So as you have it presented is what they would really like to build, except that subsequently, since we've issued these drawings to you, they've gotten some pricing from contractors. And what they've decided is that they still want to do the garage. They're still asking for the garage, but they do not intend to do the roof over the patio. I spoke to Mr. Grill earlier, and I told him that they are going to probably not build the roof over the patio. And Mr. Grill told me that they probably still need the variance for the corner yard because of the size of the patio in the corner side yard. So we are still asking for the variance for both yards. They probably will not proceed with the roofed area over the patio, but they do plan on building the garage and hope to build the patio as well. And Mrs. Holler is here today. Mr. Holler is not here today. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. So we'll move on to staff input, Director Grill.
In doing a review on this proposal, staff looked at the existing streetscapes that exist on South Wisconsin and West Madison Avenue. The West Madison Avenue setbacks are very consistent and very regimented is the best word I can say. It's 40 feet, and every home is right virtually at that 40 feet. Wisconsin, it's a little bit different story. However, this residence is closer to Wisconsin Avenue than the rest of the homes going south until you get down to the next block. So any encroachment on that corner side yard setback is going to have an impact on the streetscape. Staff did entertain the thought that they, on the site plan that's labeled T1.0, that they have an existing concrete patio behind the what would be existing one-car garage that would have the ability to extend up to 5 feet away from that east property line. But in looking at the floor plan that has been developed, the only way to get there is either through the master bedroom or through the kitchen, which is not necessarily good access to a patio. The fact now that the petitioner is wishing not to do the covered patio and instead just have a patio, code allows the encroachment of a front porch or patio up to 25% into the required yard setback. In this case, it being a corner side yard, the setback is 20 feet, which means we would be able to allow a patio to encroach 5 feet or to within 15 feet of the front lot line. Again, it comes down to a matter of aesthetics that, you know, they're already closer to Wisconsin than the rest of the homes on the east side of South Wisconsin. So you will be able to notice this. However, they don't have a lot of options either in that their rear yard along the east side of the property is limited to what they can do. So, and without a porch or covering over that patio, the impact on that streetscape will be significantly reduced. So if the Plan Commission were interested in making a recommendation on that, they can make the following motion. That to approve application PZ0009 for Thomas Knapp and Douglas Holler that includes a variation to the required 40-foot rear yard setback to 12.2 feet for the purposes of constructing an attached two-car garage, and two, a variation to the required corner side yard setback of 20 feet to 10 feet for the purposes of constructing an uncovered patio at 803 South Wisconsin Avenue as portrayed in Exhibit A attached, with the following conditions: that the proposed two-car garage and the partially covered and that the uncovered front patio be constructed generally as noted on sheet T1.0 prepared by TR Knapp Architects and last dated March 9th, 2017, with the removal of the existing concrete pad as noted at the southwest corner of the property. And then two, that the exterior elevation be constructed generally in conformance with the exterior elevation sheet A3.0 prepared by TR Knapp Architects last dated March 9th, 2017. With a finding of fact, as included in the staff memo dated March 31st, 2017, that such variation meets the standards enumerated in Article 6.7B of Appendix C of the Municipal Code of the Village Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance. I also wish to note that this notice was properly published in the Daily Herald on March 27, 2017. With that, I'll answer any questions that the Commission may have.
Thank you. We're going to move on to public participation and questions. Are there any members of the public wishing to speak in regards to this petition? I'm seeing no one. So we move into questions from Commission members.
Condition number one states that removal of the existing concrete pad is noted in southwest corner of the property. However, there's going to be a curb cut and stuff on the parkway. Whose responsibility is it to take care of that?
Would be the petitioner.
Okay. Could we add that maybe? Because right now it just reads as the concrete parking pad.
That's just the way it goes.
That would be, yeah.
That's already in the rules. They have to cut the curbs.
They're taking out the pad, and then we have the curb cut, and then all the grass that has to go back into the apron that's being removed.
Yeah, there's if you
that'd
go
be all part of the engineering,
right? But if you go on T1.0, it looks like the existing was, but I think maybe staff is referring to this other 10-foot. If you go back to the first page, there looks to be a pad, and that. Go ahead, sorry.
Well, if I may,
yeah,
provide
please.
Some clarification. There's some wording on sheet T1.0 that indicates there's an existing concrete pad at the southwest corner of the site.
Yeah.
It's a beaten up gravel area.
It's on the pad of survey too.
Right. But what I'm saying, it currently does not function as a parking pad.
Mm-hmm.
And given the configuration of the site plan on sheet T1.0, staff believes that should be removed because the configuration of the apron and the driveway width does not allow access to that mm-hmm. existing concrete pad.
So then the apron on the driveway there, at the end of the driveway is going to be then replaced by the petitioner?
Correct, yes.
You know, we're looking at a Google Earth here, and it looks like that is almost like a shared drive situation with the neighbor?
Well, it was part of a, it was an alley that was vacated years ago.
Oh, I see.
And half went to the north property owner and half went to the south property owner.
Okay. But staff, your recommendation there, your condition there is to get rid of that, correct?
Correct.
Basically.
Yeah, okay.
Remove that.
Yeah.
T1.0.
And then this, the old curb cut.
Will have to be removed.
And they're gonna, but that's, okay, and the petitioner's going to patch the curb?
Yes.
And take that off the driveway there?
That's correct.
Parkway there?
Because given the lot size, they only permitted one curb cut anyway.
Okay.
Okay. Other questions?
So they're gonna be filling in that whole vacated alleyway, even into the neighbor's yard, or is it gonna be all green or no?
Just on their property?
No, just on their property.
Okay.
Because the neighbor's driveway takes off from that point.
Okay.
Looking at Google Earth.
What the manual plan, what is the permeable surface percentage? I'm looking through the memorandum and not seeing that, so it would be, where is it?
25%.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't get the memorandum for this.
I guess I have a question for the architect. So the reason for the two-car garage is that the existing garage was diminished in its capacity because of the kitchen addition. I get that. But then the new garage wouldn't add on till the end of the present garage. And so you kind of makes a, it makes the addition that much larger, if you will. So why wasn't the decision made to have the new garage start at that furthest projection of the kitchen wall and then create the two-car garage? Because it's a good-sized two-car garage. It's 27 by 28, which is a good-sized two-car garage. So you're getting at least 2.5, almost a three-car garage in terms of its total square foot area. So I guess, what was the reasoning for that?
First of all, because the back patio is not very useful for them, even the way it is currently, and also because the garage being proposed at 22 feet wide by 27 feet long, that will basically be a 2.5 car garage that will be used for automobiles and storage. And then the existing garage area is going to be used as his home wood shop.
Okay, but it's also is what's creating this need to go so far into the setback, correct? I mean, that added square footage, it's not just garage, it's the wood shop that's pushing us.
Well, the 22 feet for a garage is a pretty standard width of a two-car garage in order to get cars in, parked properly, and access those vehicles. So I use 22 feet as sort of the standard garage width for the proposed addition. And it seemed to make sense to me that him using the existing garage space as his home wood shop would work pretty well.
I guess what I'm saying, though, is the home workshop space is not necessary to be able to get cars in. That's kind of what I'm saying.
That's true.
Yeah.
And in order to remodel that space, in order to use it, in order to remodel some of the existing space to use as part of the new two-car garage, that would require them to do a considerable amount of demolition to the existing wall and roof above. So I think it would be more complicated that way. I think the way that we're showing it, the roof lines are pretty straightforward, and the addition, the extension of existing wall lines are pretty straightforward.
I understand that aspect of it, but it's pushing the size, I guess, is my question. Does it need to be that large to accommodate the family's needs? Because if you could say, 3-4 feet, now you're getting back to more of a 15-foot setback instead of 12. Where we're it's really looking for 40 foot. And I realize the original house doesn't meet the setback requirements anyway. I realize that it doesn't meet those. But.
And if I may, as Mr. Grill pointed out, there is a vacated alley at the back of this property.
Mm-hmm.
All of the properties on the interior properties, they all have garages that were built according to that vacated alley. Because the house was built when that alley existed, The garage was built as a side load garage off of the street as opposed to off of the alley. I can't explain why exactly, but all of the other yards in the back have garages that are set almost exactly where our addition is being shown right now. So that seems to make sense that we're not really asking for what is abnormal for the community.
So the problem that I'm having, though, is I look at T1.0, and I've got the garage, and I have a property line, and it says 12.2 feet. But then I'm noticing that on the plat of survey, that property line is actually at a diagonal. It's not orthogonal to the house. So...
I'm sorry, I don't have the survey with me.
Okay. I'm having a problem kind of reconciliating the two drawings with each other to understand where that 12.2 feet is. I mean, how much green space do we have between that garage and that vacated alley or the driveway of the neighbor? See what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. If you look at the, would be the northwest corner, it shows that it's about 86.5
right.
degrees, so you've got slightly trapezoidal
right.
lot, not a true rectangle, which is what...
And actually, the front yard actually has a little bit of the front lot line also has a little bit of a diagonal as well. The way that I got my dimensions was taking the 41.7-foot front yard and a 64.2 building length and subtracting that from the 140. If that makes sense to you. Because there's on the survey, there it does not dimension from the rear line of the building to the rear property line.
I guess what I'm wondering, the 130 though seems to go to the center line of the vacated alley. So it seems to be platted with that vacated alley being included as part of this parcel. Yeah, 140. But it's actually only 130 on, it's 140 here, but it's 130 here.
Right, but if this was vacated and deeded, then it's 140 feet.
Yeah.
140 feet. I think what you're asking is whether the vacated alley is included in that lot dimension or
yep.
excluded.
That's what I'm asking.
And I believe, from what I'm looking at, it seems to me that the vacated alley is included in that lot dimension. That's my opinion from reviewing it right now. And additionally, the existing parking slab that Mr. Grill was discussing earlier.
Mm-hmm.
That entire vacated alley, because that was built as an alley, is extremely, it's a hard packed gravel. There is growth on it now, grass growth, but it's very sparse because they said that they've had a very hard time keeping growing things in that area because of the hard packed gravel. Which is why in my drawing, I thought we could just leave that parking area where it was.
Yeah, it's not... It doesn't meet our ordinance in terms of...
I understand.
Okay.
So are we saying that the 12 feet will encompass 10 feet of alley? So we really only have 2 feet? Oh, no? Okay.
10 feet of what used to be alley.
What used to be alley.
It's been vacated.
Right. But is it their property?
It's their
now?
Property.
Yeah.
It's vacated and deeded over.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, it's their property.
Okay, gotcha.
But it does look like that from the proposed garage to the lot line is 12.2 feet in the neighborhood.
I just did quick envelope math myself with the dimensions on here, and I wound up with 12 feet on the south side, so.
Yeah, okay.
That 12 feet is based on the 140 feet, which would include the 10-foot vacated portion.
The house has a basement, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right, any other questions from commission members?
I have a couple.
Okay, go ahead.
The
existing area that's sided, that's going to be filled in with brick, that's what you propose?
At this point, I believe they're going to do the entire addition as frame, I believe. Is that?
So you're going to side over the brick then?
No, just the addition. The addition, the new addition will be a frame addition as opposed to masonry.
In addition to the frame patch of the old garage?
Correct.
And that's going to remain frame?
Yeah.
And then that cover over the front porch, that or over the patio, that's gone. That's
yeah, the entire roof over the front entry doorway will be eliminated from the scope of work. And so, I actually wanted to draw attention to when Mr. Grill brought the following conditions, he did revise the request, but he did not revise the condition number two, which is that the exterior be built according to the elevations that we show. Because we're not building that covered porch area,
right,
obviously that would need to be revised as well.
And but he did say 8.3.0 on his recommendation, and it talked about infilling that one area with brick and then brick on the addition. So the garage now is just going to be attached to the house, but it's not going to look like the house, correct?
It will be siding as opposed to masonry.
Okay, and then
otherwise it'll
that
be essentially
dip in the roof line. What's that? Is that's just it's not a straight ridge? I mean, the pictures seem to be a straight ridge going across, yeah, unless I'm missing something.
If you look at the if you look at the survey, how there's the patio behind the kitchen area.
Yeah.
The roof is just a straight gable from end to end, but because the house is not as wide there, the ridge is actually lower in that area.
I saw that, but I mean, I'm just the drawings are fooling me.
If you look at the picture on the back, you can actually see the little bit of gable sticking up.
Okay.
Of the front port, the front, the north portion. So it's like the gables are different heights.
So you already have different heights, and your drawing will be, your garage then will be.
Be symmetrical with the
other end of the house.
Correct.
All right. Yeah. Those are the only questions I have.
Yeah.
It's differing widths.
Okay. Any other questions, commission members?
Was this area that's considered the existing dining room and kitchen, was that a one-car garage at one time? So that was closed up? It was. Okay, I thought so. Okay.
I'm not sure how the progress of the kitchen was.
One-car garage closed up, now another one.
It does look like the way the kitchen was remodeled, it was added into the garage parking space. I don't know exactly how that was permitted, but...
Well, it's probably a real tiny kitchen.
Yeah.
Okay. If there's no other comments by commission questions by commission members, any closing comments that you'd like to make, or any closing comments?
No, just thanks for letting me present.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments by the public in regards to this petition? Seeing none, we're going to move into, we're going to close the public hearing. Any discussion by commission members?
Even though it's kind of close to the property line, when you look at the neighborhood and you look down Wisconsin Avenue, the homes are separated by a driveway width, 15 feet or something. So, you know, it seems like it's really close to the property line, but when you look, you know, at a satellite view, it's... It still has a lot of elbow room between it and its neighbor.
So the question that was asked before.
Any other comments?
I would agree with Greg that it's, you know, it's while it's pushing the envelope, it is not infringing on neighbors, in my opinion. My only concern is the impervious.
Mm-hmm.
It's certainly going to look a whole lot better than the existing house.
I guess the question is the impervious surface, was it calculated with keeping that gravel pad? So if we eliminate that gravel pad and excavate the stone and create green space there, does that get you closer?
I believe it did include the parking pad, and then if we reduce that, if we eliminate that parking pad, that we will have less impervious surface.
Okay.
Also, if we were not building the roofed area,
mm-hmm.
I might be able to make the brick patio a little bit smaller.
Okay.
Because it was meant to be a dining patio mm-hmm. and an entry patio. By eliminating the roof, we could maybe perhaps make the brick area a bit smaller as well.
Okay.
Then my last question here, or comment actually, is they're going to come off the side here. 22 feet puts it really close to these overhead wires. And is there a utility easement that needs to be? These are overhead wires right here.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a utility easement that this is encroaching on?
No. I think
it probably is,
Patrick,
actually. I don't think you can build
that.
A garage under them.
No, you can't.
No, you wouldn't be able to. But in terms of there being easement, if that's just a service connection, there wouldn't be the need to put it in an easement.
Oh, it's going like to the neighbor's house or something?
Right.
Okay, these aren't, because I went past. This is like a main feed for the neighborhood. What it does, it goes down behind all the homes there on Madison, behind all the streets. So this is kind of like a main feed here. And that's one of the things I wanted to mention. Because I know you have those utility easements that need to be respected. And do we know for sure what that is here and how close it is to it? And
yeah, well,
I couldn't answer that
question. Yeah, and so basically when they would go get a permit and, you know, the Commonwealth Edison would have to be contacted and they'd have to work out what's going to happen to that service, whether it gets buried or whatever the case may be. But
okay,
it would be part of the permit process.
Okay.
All right, any other comments? You know, I appreciate that what other commissioners are saying in regards to the neighborhood and the context, and I can understand the petitioner wanting to create some additional space for storage and so on in the garage, and the additional cost of taking down existing walls in order to build this new garage. So I feel a lot better about it since the roof isn't going to be on the side yard, because I think that was going to be really stand out.
I agree. Just looking at the setbacks along Wisconsin, they're all set back quite a bit, and this is the closest by a long shot.
Yeah.
And that coming out another 10 feet.
But in terms of an open patio, I think that's great. I think it'll enhance the look of the property and the walk, you know, new walkway to the driveway, a new driveway, and getting rid of that gravel pad, I think will all be enhancements. Any other discussion? If not, we could have a motion.
I just have a hard time with the two different materials. It's going to stand out just the way somebody took that garage space, made it living space. And now we're putting another frame area. I mean, I'd pass it in a heartbeat if the material existed. If that opening was bricked up and the garage was bricked up, then I could agree with my commission members. But if it's not going to match, just can't. Aesthetically, it's going to look exactly
the existing house does have a sided portion in the middle of it.
Yeah, this?
Yeah,
that's the old garage door.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'd love to see that go away, and I'd love to see the garage be brick also. But to me, it's going to look more like that on the side of the house now. So I just...
Or at least masonry bottom, vinyl above that. No, like it looks like an accent piece. No, you don't think so?
I mean, I just think it should all be masonry.
I tend to agree. I think that that old garage door should be bricked in, possibly, potentially make it an all brick house. I don't know if that, you know, that add-on necessarily needs to be a brick garage.
I just agree.
Yeah, it's not, this isn't going to really fix that problem with the infill. It's like the windows have been made. Something's different about the proportion between the
infill, or door, masonry walk.
Between the photo and the drawing.
Yeah, these windows are different.
I'm looking at black and white.
Well, that's, no, this is all brick. There's the original.
There's the original infill.
They're actually, the architects, but they, I think they're relocating this window? And moving the door, is that correct?
You're putting patio doors in the dining room?
Yeah, I'm sorry. They're
replacing the window with the door and added and moving the window eastward.
Oh, here it is, yeah. They're putting doors in where those windows are existing now.
If I may?
Yeah.
The owners, when they were talking about building the covered patio, wanted to open up from their existing kitchen dining room out to the covered patio. With the elimination of the roof, they were talking about, right now, they're primarily interested in the garage and doing the garage addition.
Okay, so this elevation isn't correct, then, is what
that's
trying to tell me.
That's correct.
My sense right now is that to vote for this, I think we might want to have revised drawings.
Yeah,
that's true.
What do the commission members think of, in regards to the statement that was just made by Commissioner Geer?
I'd like to see some updated drawings.
Updated drawings.
I could envision what it's going to look like. I don't need updated drawings.
So I think, well, I think let's give the architect a chance to respond to some of the concerns and also to figure out what the resolution is without there being a roof, right? Which you haven't had a chance to
do. As I said, this came up in the last, just the last few days. Please talk about it with Mr. Grill.
Yeah, so it sounds like that's consensus would be that we would
continue.
Suggest a continuance for this till next month, till you can change the drawings. That's what I'm hearing.
Understood.
Okay. So I need a motion for that.
I would make a motion to continue petition PZ170009. To a date certain of May 12th, 2017? No, May 11th, 2017.
We have a motion, a second on that motion?
I'll second that motion.
Any questions or comments? Hearing none, we'll vote. Commissioner Rickel?
Yes.
Commissioner Bello?
Yes.
Commissioner Jarrett?
Yes.
Commissioner Orlowski?
Yes.
Gatto?
Yes.
Hassler?
Yes.
Jackson?
Yes.
I too vote yes. Thank you. I think that'll be very helpful to really address the concerns that you heard tonight. Thank you.
Can I add something? If you could, on the elevation, you know, work with the siding aspect of it so it doesn't jump out at you. I understand, you know, brick is way more expensive than siding. But aesthetically, if you could do something to blend it, that would be great.
Great. Thank you.
One of the issues that the owner brought up, she was just here, is that if we tried to match the brick to a 1950s brick, it would be very difficult to do anyway. One of the reasons we decided to, when they eliminated the porch, there was some masonry on the porch, and we were talking about doing some ways to find some ways to make it match better, which is why it was designed the way it was. When they eliminated the porch, they said they would eliminate the mason as well. That's why we eliminated the brick infill from the openings.
Yeah, well, I think take a look at it and come back with a solution that, you know, you heard some of the concerns about aesthetics on this primary facade, and I think this is a chance to maybe rectify some of the aesthetics that we see today.
Absolutely.
Wasn't there
Thank you.
On the drawings, wasn't there an interior wall that you guys are going to take down? There's an existing
exterior. We closed this.
We closed the
okay. We continued this. We need to
move Vince
on.
Started gabbing, and
I know.
Said,
I know. Thank you. Let's keep going. Thank you. Okay. We are at petition, unless somebody needs a break. Anybody need a break?
Let's keep going.
Okay. Petition PZ170010,
special use for preliminary PUD at 257 to 277 East North Park Avenue. Petitioner is Villa Park Associates, LLC. Is there someone here representing the petitioner this evening? So anyone that is going to speak in regards to this, please come forward now and get sworn in. Okay, so you're going to need to, as you each begin to speak, state your name and address for the record, but you may proceed.
Okay. Joe Whiteside, 47 West, 210 U.S. Highway 30, Big Rock, Illinois. Appreciate the committee's time to review what we have. I'm going to go through a couple slides, go through sort of what we're doing, and then we've got a series of people that can answer specific questions, architect, engineers.
Great.
You ready, Vanna? We were here about a month ago. I'm not sure if we went through some of this before. But this here is architectural rendering of what we're proposing. It's about 18,000 square feet on the first floor, and then a 4,000 square foot sort of loft mezzanine that would be on the western side of the building. There's still a little bit of consternation about the number of windows. We think it may have too many windows, especially on the upper level. So we may take a look at taking away some of those windows and maybe a few windows up front. But let's say all in all, this is pretty much what we're sort of looking at building. And then our architect can sort of speak a little bit more toward the materials and so forth. But that sort of gives you a kind of a bird's eye view as far as what we're going to build. So this is some elevations, sort of corresponds with the rendering. Again, on the east and west side of the building, we have, we may have too many windows there, and then also to the south, maybe you have too many windows to the south as well, but gives you, again, sort of an idea of what we're looking at building. Okay, this is just survey. You can stop there. Yeah, right there is good. One of the comments that we got early with the staff was that with the traffic report, there was some concern that the eastern entrance on North Avenue, people could see sort of straight through to Schiller, which is on the south side, the southeast portion of the property. So I'm not sure if we have a slide that shows it, but what we did was we moved that Schiller entrance two or three parking spots over to the west, so it sort of corresponds with the trash enclosure that's in the southeast portion of the building. So, so the entrance is about, I don't know, 20 or 30 feet to the west to accommodate the concerns with traffic. So I think, we also asked the city for maybe a relook at the traffic with the different entrance. I don't know if we got any more feedback on that or not, but.
Well, that's what staff is looking for.
Okay, so we made that change per staff's recommendation. So basically we have an east and west right in, right out from North Avenue. I think currently there's sort of like three entrances, so we're going to sort of take one away. It's sort of a quasi entrance, and then we're just going to end up with two. And then we're looking at putting a restaurant or another, it could be a multi-tenant use, but we're showing right now a drive-through. I think it's, my eyes are bad, but I think recollection, I think it's about 4,300 square feet. And then we have the building to the back, again, 18,000 square feet with a 4,000 square foot loft mezzanine type thing. And I've lost track of the count of parking, but I think it's about 171 or 173, something like that, which I think it's about four over what the code would be for the combination of the drive-through restaurant and the health club. So there's a few extra. One of the staff comments was that are we going to have a cross-access, cross-parking type arrangement? We will. So we'll have to work with the city staff as far as how we do that. We're going to put it on the plat of subdivision and probably just do something simple to get started with. But whatever the staff would like us to do, we're fine to comply with whatever, how they want us to structure it. There's a trash enclosure on the east side of the restaurant building, and then there's a trash enclosure to the southeast portion of the health club, being Export Fitness. I'm not sure how many people know about us, but we have 40 locations in Chicago, New York, and DC. We have about 30 here in Chicago area. All of our clubs are open 24 hours, 7 days a week. We know we'll be successful here because we have a club in Elmhurst. It's 9,500 square feet, and we have 5,000 members. So to give you some perspective, that's a lot. So we're excited to bring those members here. We probably will have somewhere in the neighborhood of 7,500 to 8,000 members once we move over. That's pretty much all the comments that I have. I can, you know, leave it. Here's the building signage facing north. I think there's two pylon signs or two monument signs. That would be the sign that we're looking to put on the far west side of the site, right next to the entrance, the western entrance. That's got the our signage plus a reader board, and then potential of two other tenants, sign panels. And I think then there's another monument sign, which would be for the restaurant user that would be sort of right out in front of their property on North Avenue, sort of equidistant between the west drive and the east drive. That's all I have for now. If there's any questions, engineering or architecture, we have got the crew here. Unless, Craig, did you want to talk about anything or just wait for comments? Okay, sounds good.
Thank you. Mr. Grill?
This was one of the most comprehensive submittals for a PUD that we've had in quite some time. A lot of information to go through, but we have been working with Export Fitness for a while on this property. Some of you may know it as the old Ladderwig property. It used to be a bunch of RVs and boats parked on this property. The village has been marketing it for quite some time. And we finally have a development which
provides a use that is needed on the north side of town, and will provide a very nice physical presence along this stretch of North Avenue. They're showing, you know, mostly the Export Fitness facility. Obviously, this is more of a two-lot development that's going to include a retail outlet in front of it, not unlike the old North or the North Park Plaza Shopping Center. You've got the larger building in the back, smaller building up front. They currently do not have a tenant for that building, but we are looking at this as a preliminary PUD anyway. Any additional development still has to come back to the P&Z for final approval, because staff is concerned about the type of architecture and design of that outlot building. But obviously, until they have a tenant, there are a lot of directions that that design could go in, and I don't necessarily want to handcuff them at this point if it meant losing a good tenant. So staff is certainly willing to wait on the design element for that outlot until they actually have somebody who is interested in the property. Staff reviewed the site plan. Mr. Whitehouse is right in that staff has asked that that entrance be offset on the east side of the property, so it's not a straight shot from North Avenue to Schiller. And that's going to be revised. Staff has not seen the sign plan, the monument signs, although they did speak about them in the various variations that they wanted, or departures that they wanted, specifically the use of an electronic message board that would have basically an unlimited use of graphics and things like that. I know this commission spent a significant amount of time on the electronic message board and came up with the 3-second rule and no moving graphics. So that certainly would be, I feel, a significant departure from what we have allowed in the past. Additionally, they wanted to extend the development schedule for Lot 2. Staff doesn't necessarily have a problem with that. But they also wanted a departure not mentioned in the rider, but it's shown on the plan, so that if something got missed for whatever reason, if it was shown on the plan, they'd be able to do it. Staff doesn't like to, that's sort of a carte blanche kind of thing, and staff does wish to reserve the ability to say, we missed that, and that's not a good design, or that's not, proper engineering. The use at this location certainly is permitted under the zoning. Landscape plan, staff felt was a very good landscape plan. Obviously, it had to be modified and massaged based on the revision of that access point onto Schiller Avenue. And I don't feel that that's going to be a big issue with staff or with the developer. So, that being said, if the commission is supportive of the request, they could choose to approve application PZ 170010 for a preliminary PUD for property at 257 to 277 East North Avenue with the following PINs 06031010005, 06031029, and 06031010030 with the following conditions. The site plan be developed generally in accordance with the preliminary site grading plan prepared by Cage Civil Engineering as sheet 5.0 and dated March 10, 2017. That a separate document be created titled Preliminary PUD Plan that includes all the physical improvements shown on the site grading plan, sheet C50, but without the underlying engineering detail and landscape improvements. that the elevation of the Export Fitness Building be constructed as shown on sheet 1.1 as prepared by NWS Architects Incorporated, dated March 8, 2017. That landscaping be installed as shown on the landscape plan as prepared by Gary R. Weber Associates and dated March 6, 2017. And including an explanation of how this plan meets the requirements of Article 20.14.G.2 of the zoning ordinance. Specifically along the south side of the property, they're supposed to provide a solid screen. And I want to hear from the architect, the landscape architect, is how he thinks he meets that particular section of the code. That parkway trees be added along Schiller Street as required in Chapter 21, Article 3 of the Municipal Code, and that lighting be installed per the photometric plan as prepared by Cage Civil Engineering, sheet PH1.0 and PH2.0, and dated March 10, 2017, with a finding of fact as included in the staff memo dated March 31, 2017, that such special use meets the standards enumerated in Article 6.10.D of Appendix C of the Municipal Code of the Village of Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance. I also wish to notice that this notice was properly published in the March 29th, 2017 edition of the Daily Herald. With that, I'll open it up to any questions that the commission may have.
Thank you.
And real quick, the site plan that's shown now shows where that entrance is.
Thank you.
On Schiller.
The shifted Schiller Street access. Thank you. Okay, we're going to move into public participation and questions. Are there any members of the public wishing to speak in regards to this petition? I'm hearing no one. So we're going to, and seeing no one that wishes to speak, so I'm going to move into questions from commission members.
There's a memo here from the fire department. There's an underground detention vault that they had some concerns that you can handle the weight of their vehicles and the turning radius of their vehicles. Are they able to move around that parking lot? And I'm wondering if these items were addressed.
Greg Horst with Cage Civil Engineering. The comments from the fire department, we'll have no problem addressing those comments. As far as the structural requirement of the vault, the detention vault, that will be part of our final design, and it will be adequately designed to carry their load.
All right.
Okay. I have two questions.
Sure.
You're going to build the export building first, and then as you find a tenant, you'll build the second building. Do you think that, you know, looking at the drawing, do you think that lot is underutilized with what you're proposing? Is there a chance where you would have two outbuildings or something like that?
Yeah,
I'd like to maximize the land usage. Sorry.
Yeah, I don't think it's big enough to carry two separate buildings. Could be multiple tenants, or maybe two or three tenants, maybe at the end of the day.
But you are leaving yourself open for, you know, to maximize the land.
Absolutely. Yes, sir.
That was my question.
I think we had a discussion too when we were here first about the to gravel lot now, somewhat pervious, and then of course all the asphalt in the building itself. There's a lot of wasn't there some discussion about concrete or something or area
attention.
Putting it in there and doing something. Like pervious pavers or something?
Yeah.
I mean, it's up to them to. We don't have a requirement for pervious pavers, and they're going to have to meet the stormwater ordinance, which it sounds like they have a vault plan, which is what it looks like you would need because everything else is paved or building.
Yeah.
So they're going to meet the ordinance through a vault, so they're going to meet those requirements.
It's an expensive option for some.
Yeah, the vaults aren't cheap. So I think that's okay. My concern was going to be the opposite, was is that restaurant going to potentially detract from or block? I think you've got the Export Fitness. I've seen other buildings. You do a nice job. They're nice looking developments, and that's my only concern is when I look at the site plan.
It kind of mentions in the memo, I remember reading that one of the reasons they want the ability to put moving graphics on the signs is the potential for the site to be the fitness center to be missed because it's mm-hmm. behind the restaurant building.
Yeah. I think coming from the east, that's a possibility. I think the rendering has this shot from the, as if you're coming from west to east, you know, it sort of opens up because of where the restaurant is positioned. What's the vision for the restaurant, though? Is it like a fast food?
Right.
I mean, I know you don't have a tenant yet, but.
Yeah. We'd like to pursue a couple of nationals that are considered the top of the, you know, high A type tenant.
Because one of the things that, and Mr. Grill mentioned this, one of the things that we looked at North Park and were, as those outlots came in, where they're really, we're looking for a four-sided building there because, you know, there is no back of the building for those restaurants. And so that's something that's going to be important to us as you look towards a tenant. We're going to be looking to what do all the elevations look like and where, how's the trash screen? Because I think it's important for you as well, you know, to run Export Fitness. You want this nice experience from Parking Place into the building.
I agree. It's our, you know, we're going to be facing the back side of that restaurant.
Right.
So, yeah, I agree.
Okay. So, and then if it won't be developed at the same time, do you foresee that there might be a portion of time where you just pave over that spot and park in it?
Yes.
That would be your interim solution? Okay.
It's not the preferred, but and it's hard to, you know, we wanted to get a feel from the committee for how you felt about this before we start really pursuing other tenants. Once you feel like you guys are good with it, then gives us incentive to be a little bit more aggressive.
Yeah, understood.
Other questions?
I think, you know, in terms of the recommendation that Director Grill read out, it sounds like there's some technical work to be done in regards to validation but the intention is that the landscape plan meets our ordinance requirements, including the buffer yard on Schiller Street, right? That's the intention, is it?
Yeah, I'm not sure if we got specific comments, but we're certainly happy to
Okay, and same thing with lighting, meeting our you know, because we have residential neighbors here, so we need to be respectful and have the cutoffs and all that and meet the light levels. Okay.
Sure.
And then in regards to signage, I think I heard staff say they have not yet calculated or reviewed the signage area calculations and to see, you know, is that something that's part of the PUD ask that's beyond our ordinance?
If the petitioner submits plans that meet the zoning requirements in our sign regulations, we would allow it. It doesn't necessarily have to be approved as part of the PUD. Now, obviously, if they want to go above and beyond what the sign code allows, you do it as part of the PUD.
So. Right, so I guess I'm just asking, how far have we gotten in that process? Do you know? Have you calculated?
I think, don't hold me to this.
Sure.
I think the signs are according to code. Now the question, I think the only question is the graphic, you know, that was sort of a last minute thought. So
sure.
You guys, if you have some restrictions you want to apply to that, we're okay with that, but it'd be nice to have. But I think in general, I think this with the sign dimensions is what I think needs to go. And if they don't, we'll review it again, and then we'll come back and, you know, we'll ask for the variances. So.
Yeah, I think my question comes from two monument signs. That's not something we...
Two lots.
Two lots.
It's right. Two lots, so they'd be able to have a monument sign for each lot.
And the other thing that we find is on the restaurants, national restaurants, their definition of signage and ours somewhat diverges.
Sure.
So they typically they'll come in with their typical sign package and it'll be beyond what we typically allow. So just be aware of that, that when we review that, that is something that, you know, even to talk to staff, they know what we typically recommend, don't recommend in regards to sign package for those. I would like to say that we're accommodating, but we are also not looking for, you know, huge signage all over everything.
And they have to play ball.
Yeah.
You know, with whatever your rules are. Okay. So. Okay. But being up on North Avenue, there's
yeah, absolutely. And we want to make sure that there's visibility. We want these businesses to be viable and attractive, all those things. Great. Anything else you guys have?
I think it's a great utilization for that
space. I'm familiar with this Downers Grove location, and actually the elevation of the street and the elevation of the property. If you don't know, you don't even see the building from the street.
Probably, yeah.
But I know your parking lot's always full.
Yeah. They do a nice job.
Just south of Butterfield.
Okay. Well, any other, if there's no other questions, we'll move on. And any other closing comments that you'd like to make tonight?
Just appreciate your time, and whatever the staff wants to recommend or whatever you guys would like us to do, you know, our plan is to be here for the next 30 years, so we plan to be part of the fabric of the community. So,
right.
You know, we want to do whatever you guys want us to do.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate that. Thank you. Any members of the public wishing to speak? I still see no one, so we're going to close that up and go to discussion by commission members. Any further discussion?
One thing that it seems kind of minor on the face of it, but the request for the scrolling graphics and so on the sign, I personally can't support that because we spent the better part of 2.5 years creating our sign ordinance, and the village board wrestled with that. Probably for just about that long before it was finally approved. It's been staff has had to enforce that on other businesses in the community. And I understand your concerns with visibility, but having that advantage with signs that other businesses don't have is not equitable, and that's what the ordinance is about. In this instance, there may need more thought, maybe needed to be put into how to make this more visible, or your signage more visible on North Avenue, if that's the reason for doing it. If it's just to get more business, it's not equitable. That's my thought on that.
Well, and I was just, it was a process, and I just, there's no way, I don't feel like anyone on this board could vote to recommend to the board to reconsider it for this property.
Years of meetings between us, traffic and safety, economic development.
Yes.
It was a fight. I mean, it really was to get to where we got.
It was a negotiation.
Right, a negotiation to get to where we got. Some people wanted more, some people wanted less. Right. We got to something that
And I think if you want to see, I think someone that does it well is the development that's on, right, if you go Ardmore, and they're on Roosevelt Road, just east of Ardmore.
Through the courtyard?
Is that courtyard? Yeah. If you look at that strip center and just see, they follow, and they have good graphics, and they represent their tenants quite nicely. And I think you'll see the 3 seconds is really much quicker than what you'd think.
They were actually one of the. I don't want to say our ordinance was based on them, but.
Yeah.
They were one of the ones we looked to as not going too far while still allowing them some freedoms as a business owner, property owner.
So for clarity's sake, you're not necessarily saying you're against the graphics, it's just the speed.
It's the speed,
correct.
And the change rate of the images,
okay.
And that the images then when they're on aren't moving.
Okay.
Yeah. And so again, I think if you go just sit in the parking lot and watch a few sign changes there, you'll see that you're actually able to be pretty creative and do quite a bit with it.
Sure.
It's just not, you don't get that movie screen.
Right. Graphics. Feeling. Graphics are not.
Further to the west of this property, right?
It's on Roosevelt
it's
Road.
It's on Roosevelt
between,
Road.
Between Ardmore and Summit, and it's on the north side of the street.
Yeah.
It's where Outback is.
Yeah, it's where Outback is. And I'm pointing you towards that because I think they do a good job of being within the ordinance, but being creative and doing a good job of marketing.
Right, and our sign ordinance, the electronic message board portion, that it does allow graphics. Graphics are not outlawed by that. It's basically, we had signs that were flashing. We had signs that were showing full motion video.
Right.
Some of them approaching what seemed like a small movie screen. And it was eliminating those kind of distractions and those kind of, if one person has it, maybe it's not an issue. But if every business has it, it becomes a problem.
So we're happy with however you want to sign.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion? I think it's obviously the use is very appropriate. I think it's a great development. I really appreciate that petitioner's interested in being in the community for 30 years and wants to, blend in, meet our ordinances and in terms of landscape and everything else. And I think staff appreciates the cooperation and looks forward to seeing that in the future. We certainly appreciate that because we're all trying to work with you to get the best development that we can. And as I said, we want to see you be successful in the location, so we'll work with you. But we're also trying to hold standards because we know that's good for the village and it's good for you, for users, and right, exactly, and for the neighborhood. So I'm all for this. I know that you'll be careful when you're working on lot two, and we certainly will as well as we look at it with you. But I'm all for this. So I don't know if anyone else has any other comments, or then we could do a motion.
Patrick, I have a question. As far as approving this, between that issue with the signage and the issue that you mentioned,
the rider,
the carte blanche, so to speak, on the rider, how do we need to deal with that in our approval process? Do we?
Well, if I were to make a suggestion, I would add a number 7 to the conditions, saying acceptance of the departures as included in the applicant's rider, with the exception of numbers 11 and 17. And that's assuming you don't have a problem with the development schedule.
We understand. Yeah. I think that's true for everyone up here. We understand that they're not going to happen simultaneously, that there still be a review process for Outlot 2. The interim solution will be parking, something that will look nice.
Language for that would be acceptance of the riders with departures, with the exception of 11 and 17. Does that sound correct?
It's acceptance of the departures as noted in the rider, with the exception of.
Noted. There we go. Okay.
Thank you. Motion.
I would make a motion to approve application PZ170010 for a preliminary PUD for property at 257 to 277 East North Avenue with the following pins: 0603101, 005, 029, and 030, with the following conditions. 1, that the site be developed generally in accordance with the preliminary PUD site grading plan prepared by Cage Civil Engineering as sheet C5.0 and dated March 10th, 2017. 2, that a separate document be created titled Preliminary PUD Plan that includes all the physical improvements shown on the site grading plan C5.0 but without underlying engineering detail and landscape improvements. 3, that the elevation of the Export Fitness building be constructed as shown on sheet 1.1 as prepared by NWS Architects Incorporated, dated March 8, 2017. 4, that landscaping be installed as shown on landscape plan as prepared by Gary R. Weber Associates, Incorporated, and dated March 6, 2017, and including an explanation of how this plan meets the requirements of Article 20.14.G.2 of the zoning ordinance. 5, that parkway trees be added along Schiller Street as required in Chapter 21, Article 3 of the Municipal Code. 6, that lighting be installed per the photometric plan as prepared by Cage Civil Engineering Sheet PH1.0 and PH2.0 and dated March 10, 2017. 7, acceptance of departures as noted in the rider with the exceptions of number 11 and number 17. With a finding of fact that such special use meets the standards enumerated in Article 6.10.D of Appendix C of the Municipal Code, Village of Villa Park Basic Zoning Ordinance.
There's a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second that motion.
Second. Any questions or comments on the motion as read? Seeing none, we'll vote by roll call. Commissioner Rickel.
Yes.
Bellow.
Yes.
Jarrett.
Yes.
Orlowski.
Yes.
Gatto.
Yes.
Hassler.
Yes.
Jackson.
Yes.
And with this, our recommendation will pass to the Village Board. They can either accept, reject, or modify our recommendation. Thank you very much. I'm going to propose that we take a very short break and be back at 25 after. Is that possible? Sure, everybody?
That works for me.
Thank you.
Wake me up.
We're going to resume here. So looks like everybody's back. You ready to go? Okay, we're going to resume. And we're going to open the last hearing of this evening, which is petition PZ170011, variance from required front yard setback from 35.5 feet to 32 feet, and a corner side yard setback from 20 feet to 6.5 feet for property located at 147 West Belden. Petitioner is Surinder Kalsi. Was I close?
Yes.
Great. Thank you. Come on up. So this will be the same procedure that you've seen for other petitions this evening. Anyone that's going to speak in regards to the petition needs to be sworn in. And then you'll state your name and address for the record, and we'll proceed from there.
What do you do?
I do.
Ivy, ready?
Yeah, please state your name and address for the record, and okay. Then you can proceed.
I've written out a letter which I would like to read to you. I think it would be much more
precise. Hearing problem.
Okay.
Yeah. I am an architect. My name is Nasir Ansari. I work out of my home.
Okay.
In Itasca. And I design single-family homes and home additions and small to medium-sized commercial properties. My colleague who is also the owner of the lot on the of the property, and which is located at 147 Belden Avenue in Villa Park. The frontage of the lot along Harvard Avenue is 50 feet only. It's very narrow, and the depth along Belden Avenue is 197 feet, as you can see there. This is termed a corner lot, which after leaving 20 feet side setback, which is a side yard, on Belden Avenue, and another 6 feet on the other side, will allow a barely 23 feet wide building, which will be insufficient for a reasonable design. So this is one difficulty in the side yard, which has to be 20 feet. So we are asking for a 6-foot side yard on both sides, as it is allowed for regular lots. In addition to that, the side street, which is Belden Avenue, does not intersect with the front street, which you can see here. There's the lot, and we need 20 feet setback here, and another 6 feet setback here, we need only about 23 feet of width for the building, which is too narrow. In addition to that, the Belden Avenue stops short of meeting with Harvard Avenue, so there's no intersection. So this is not practically a corner lot. So what we would like to do, if we are allowed to do a 6-foot setback, and 6-foot setback here, we will get about 37 feet, which is substantial and which will allow us to then copy. So that's what we are trying to do. And this being a as the side street, Belden Avenue does not intersect with the front street, and stopping about 150 short of it, in practical sense, it is not quite a corner lot. We therefore request a relief from the side lot, from the corner lot setback requirement of 20 feet to become 6 feet as required for a regular lot. Okay, this is what we are requesting, that you give us a relief from the 20-foot side yard requirement.
You'd like to say something?
Yeah, my name is Harpreet Kalsi. I also live in Villa Park, 1009 North Harvard Avenue. And we have built similar homes just on Harvard, three similar homes on Harvard. And then we do own lot 194 and lot 195. And on Harvard, what we are trying to build is, they have on Harvard about 10 new homes, which is similar to this. So it won't be just one big house. And since we built three houses in a row, we built, one was in 2003, 2005, and 2010. After that market very crashed, and then, you know, we're just still sitting on the lots, and if we don't get the permission for the setback, we will be in very big loss, because 22 feet compared to 37 feet will be, because these lots are very expensive when we bought the lots. And
in fact, 22 feet is so narrow that if you provide a two-car garage in the front with an access from Harwood Avenue, we'll cover the entire width. And there will not be enough room even to enter the house, so you'd have to enter from the side. And this will be very difficult to design, and will not have a good market value if we have to contain the building within 22 feet.
I get that.
At one time, these houses went, the prices were, we sold for $550 at one time, the last one we sold. So we would definitely really appreciate if you guys, if the commission can help us out. Because we bought these lots 2002, and it's been almost, 2002. And we're just paying full taxes for this.
Yeah, I understand and I appreciate that situation, but we have to look at it from a zoning perspective and developing an organized neighborhood. So, like I said, and I'm sure we all understand and can appreciate your position, but that's how we have to look at it, is from a zoning perspective.
There's an idea which I would like to convey to you. This is from here to here, this is, you know, from this lot to that lot, there is a distance of about 90 feet. Mm-hmm. And everything that we need, everything stops at this level, at this point. There's no need to say that. So this is a vacant lot. And it crossed my mind to tell you that you get rid of them in this portion of the land. They can develop this lot entirely.
Have you approached the village about vacating Belden Avenue?
Say it again?
No. Have you approached the village about vacating Belden Avenue and purchasing that?
No, we have not done that.
Okay.
Yeah, it just came to my mind now to tell you that.
Okay. So is there anything else that you want to present here at this point?
Not really.
Okay. You'll have another chance to speak again.
All right.
Thank you. Director Grill, would you like to present the staff input, please?
In evaluating this, staff looked at several parameters. The fact that Belden is not currently extended, but it is platted. And actually, the Public Works Department is looking at extending that through.
That was going to be my first question. Is that?
To Harvard. Yes. I mean, we just put the sidewalks in.
Okay.
Along the south side. Corner lots always present problems for owners. They typically never give them the amount of width they need to meet setbacks without some type of variation. You have much greater setbacks on corner lots, yet, like in this particular instance, and this is not unlike virtually every other corner lot in town, mm-hmm. it's the same width as every other lot on the block. So from that standpoint, this is not unusual.
But the
extent of the request, I believe, is unusual because in my tenure, I've never seen a variation of this size on a corner lot. And it's really a fact of the size of the home itself. What is proposed is a five-bedroom, five-bath home on this property. I'm not here to judge, how big a home you want to build on your property. But certainly, the more bedrooms you want, the more area it's going to take up. Well, staff use that as a self-created hardship. You're creating the hardship of what you need because you want to build such a large house. Staff would like to point out that in the plat survey, there are two lots shown. This lot, or this home, would fit on lot 194 without any variances at all. However, wanting to put it on 195 because you're at a corner, you've got, a much greater setback along Belden than what you have on 195 than you have on 194. Staff believes that if the petitioner cut back the size of the home to a more modest size, there wouldn't be such a need for the variance that they're asking for. I know staff typically comes up with findings on variance requests such as these, but staff was unable to come up with any findings that would even remotely come close to addressing the extent of this variation. I wish I had more insight into this than what I provided, but this is a variance unlike any other that's come forward. I don't have anything else to add at this point, so I'll just turn it back over to the commission for questions.
Thank you. Thank you for that. That was staff input. We'll move into public participation and questions. Is there any members of the public wishing to speak in regards to this petition? I'm seeing no one or hearing no one. We're going to move into questions from commission members.
What is the square footage of the proposed house?
Square footage area, not including the garage, is about, I think, 3,800 square feet.
Okay.
It was written, it is, all the data is given on the concrete item, right on the drawing.
I have a couple questions for you. So you bought the lot on Belden, correct?
Yes, sir.
And you're subdividing it into 194 and 195?
No, those are two zoning lots of record currently. No,
those are two zoning lots of record. That is correct.
When I look at the aerial, there's like a little house.
There's a small little house that was built in 1945.
Is that going to come down then?
Yes, sir.
So that little house is on 194 and 195.
95.
Okay. Got it. And what is your reason for going on the corner lot? If you built that house, you could build that house without any variations on the other lot.
Right, but I mean, either way, let's say we build 94, at one point you definitely want to build 95 too.
Yeah, but I think staff's point is the house design that you have and that you're presenting isn't designed for a corner lot. So this design would fit on 194, but for 195, you're going to have to look at the size of the lot, the fact that it's a corner setback, you're not going to have as much square footage, and you're probably going to have to come up with a different house design for a corner lot. And I think that's what staff's trying to say, and that's why this is so beyond precedent.
Yeah, just because of the 23 down to 6.
And I live in a corner lot on a 50-foot wide lot, and my house is 22 feet wide. So it's all over the village.
I have the same situation. Is there a reason that, so I'm looking here, and it says that you're set back 32 feet from Harvard, but you're required to be set back 35 and a half.
I think that's just a mistake.
We can maintain 35 feet.
Okay.
There is enough room on the back to push it back.
Because I was going to say, I thought there was enough setback in the back to push it back.
I was under the impression that the setback requirement was 30 feet, so I made the house 32 feet.
It's an average.
Feet, so we can move the house back.
You know, that's why I asked if the city was going to develop Belden, and since they're going to develop Belden, you would be 6.5 feet then from the sidewalk, and it's just that is not typical. It's way outside of the box.
At least, I know we're asking for too much. Maybe at least we get some relief.
Well, I think from our perspective, I'm kind of looking around. Consensus is that, do you guys agree with what staff has said and the general direction of this, that Belden's going to get improved? 6 feet is not going to be enough.
In 103 years of Villa Park's history, Belden has not been improved. But all of a sudden, it's something that is on the...
Well,
I mean, we can't get the potholes patched in this town, but we're going to extend
But there's sidewalks that have been poured.
Well, here's what I say.
I understand. And I guess the other thing, too, is that it has the Belden thing here, but if you look at it from Harvard, and it's contiguous all the way down. It does not look like a corner lot from the Harvard average.
But once you build Belden, it is. It's a corner lot.
Yeah.
It's 103 years we haven't. We're gonna. I know so right away, but they can always ask to have it vacated. And you can easily build on 194, and I totally get that. And this is a self-imposed hardship.
When I bought the lot, Mr. Greg, he's right, because I had a meeting with the Public Works when I bought the lot. And then I strictly asked if the Belden was going to go through. And they said, no, Belden will never go through. And then I had a meeting with Mr. Patrick. There was no plan of Belden to go through at that point just 1 month ago.
Yeah.
Now, all of a sudden, Belden wants to go through.
At the point when you were buying the lot would have been the time, and when the village said they didn't want it, was to ask them, would you vacate? And that would have given you, the ability to buy it or having more room. But really at this point, with this design on that lot, it's just way too much. And you're asking so far out of the box, there's no variation reason that we can give to the board to say we recommend this. There really is no hardship because of the land. There's no, there's houses all over the village that are built on corner lots that meet the setbacks. I mean, this lot's actually deeper than my lot's only 125 feet deep. And, so it's got more land to it. There's maybe some more options you can do, but you're not going to be able to use a standard sort of house plan. You're going to have to design a plan specifically for a corner lot.
One point I would like you to consider is from the edge of the pavement, Belden Avenue pavement, to the side of the house, which we are asking you allow to us, is about 30 feet already.
Yeah. So
we are vacant.
So what you need to do is to sit down with Public Works and the village and see how big a right-of-way they need for Belden to be, because that's what it's determined by. It's how big a right-of-way it is and where your property line is in relationship to it. So, they may be filling that whole right-of-way. We don't know. We're looking at zoning, and you're a 50-foot lot of record, and you're trying to put too big of a house on a corner lot. So our suggestion would be you own both lots, build the bigger house on 194, like the house that you're showing us. It's going to fit in. You don't even have to come back and see us. It's just a building permit, right? Right? You don't need a variation. Then design a house that fits on 195 with building going through, or and/or have a conversation with the village to see what's the size of the right-of-way, what size do they need, are they willing to sell off any more land so you can have more width of property. But right now you've got a 50 by 197, and there's really going to be no zoning justification as to why you can't successfully build and a house that fits on that lot, because it's certainly that way all over the village. And that's kind of the basis of zoning, right?
If I can ask you, how old is your house?
My house is from 1924.
1895. Houses these days are significantly wider than the houses built 100 years ago.
Yeah, so I think you can go look around the village, and there's other ranch houses, and there's different configurations for garages and so on. But I understand that. But that's the reality of Villa Park.
It was, we just did one this evening. Yeah. PZ 170009 is a corner lot. And
yep.
We're dealing with some setbacks on that. But that is a three-bedroom house.
Yeah. And there you're dealing with existing conditions that you're trying to
no,
help
but,
someone.
No, but
I would
be built.
Right. I'd
this
also
is
say
built from scratch.
Yeah, if a house you, can be built on
if
that
you
lot.
Built on 195, you would have more of a hardship on 194 because it's you don't have the option of building that house on 195 if 195 is already built. Also, if you came to us with something a little closer to what the village is looking for, I won't say it'll pass, but you know it'll make more sense to everybody here. This one's just really far out, and if Belden does go through, whether it's 5 years from now or 50 years from now, it's still going to be too close. So you have the vacate, if they vacate Belden, and you could buy it.
It looks like the right-of-way is huge. Maybe you can vacate part of the right-of-way.
Yeah.
Thereby increasing your lot size.
Right.
I don't know.
We want to see you develop it. We just, you have to be a little closer.
So you're saying we can buy the building?
I'm not saying you can. I'm saying ask.
Look into it. Look into it.
Because there it does look like on the drawings that you have done, there's a big distance between the property line for your lot, 195, and the edge of the paving on what was currently built for Belden.
Mm-hmm.
However, that current construction for Belden may not be wide enough. The city may be using a new roadway dimension and parkway dimension. You gotta understand all that before you can figure that out if there's any land for sale available from the village. You gotta ask. But then if there's not, you've got a 50-foot lot by 197. Come up with a design that can fit within that. And I think, you know, Commissioner Hassler's correct. The plan that was shown earlier tonight that had three bedrooms, you know, they needed a variation because they don't have as much length as you do. You've got 197. The house was built in the 30s with a single-car garage. So you'll have the opportunity to build new.
The
so,
depth for 97 feet is, I think...
Am I giving a wrong dimension?
No consequence, because it's too deep. You'll never be able to use...
It's of consequence in that you can make a longer, skinnier house and accommodate the same square footage, right?
Could you... What would they gain if they put the garage behind the house? A detached
house,
garage.
22 feet width by 100 feet depth.
There's... $4 and $5 million houses in the city of Chicago that are built on narrower lots than that. So I would just challenge you to go back and take a look at it, given the property size and the zoning ordinance.
How many between the existing building? You know, 22 feet by 80 feet?
I'm not giving you any design advice other than to say it's been done. It's done all over the village. There's nothing unique that imposes a hardship on the homeowner to build and realize their value from their property. That's in plainest speech as I can make it, right? And that's the basis of zoning in Illinois and what the basis mm-hmm. that we are able to give you variations. We have to decide that, yes, there's some kind of hardship or there's some kind of a reason that your site does not allow you to realize the full economic value of it. So for other lots in the village that are very similar to this, there's nothing about this. And matter of fact, there's an advantage because you do have some more room, so you could string out and get more square footage, right? Because the area, you could build more square feet, the area calculations can increase and everything else.
You could detach the garage.
You could detach the garage. So therefore, there's no justifiable zoning reason that we can say to the village board, you should give them a variation. They're different from every one other lot like this. You're not. Okay. That's kind of what we're trying to say.
All right.
All right?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just one last comment I want to make. I do appreciate putting up with everything, but just, we would definitely like to build this one first. If there's any way we can at least get some relief, I would appreciate it. If not, then
And what I would say to you is you're gonna need to come back with a design that addresses a corner lot and the dimensions and the zoning ordinance as it exists. So that's what I would suggest, because this design, I've been talking a lot, so I want to get consistent.
No, keep going.
I agree.
Keep going.
I'll talk too.
Yeah.
I have great appreciation for what you're doing here, and I understand that, and we want to see you succeed in that. But I think because of the parameters of the corner lot, there's not much. You know, there's other considerations like safety and if the building project goes through and those types of things.
It's easy to say that Belden hasn't gone through in 100 years. Will it go through? But as it's platted now, it is a right-of-way, and we have to respect it as that in our analysis of this. So
I think the best solution will be for the Belden to be removed, for this portion of Belden.
Well,
we would pursue that and talk to the village.
Great idea.
That will solve all the problems.
I think it's worth
providing some voluntary benefit to the village.
So, in mind, do you want us? I guess, do we want to vote on this? Do we want to continue this?
Why don't you continue? Come back with a different plan. Because if we vote and we shoot it down, you're starting all over. You know.
Well, I said that will be a choice.
But it's your choice. We can vote now, or
If we vote now,
we can come back with a different plan.
So continue. You would like us to continue to reevaluate, and
do we have to change the whole plan, or can we just change just the drawing, just the site plan, or do we have?
No, you don't have to give us drawings of the house, right?
Oh yeah. Well, we'll need at least a site plan showing how the lot's going to, you know, how the house is going to sit on the lot, and how you would, you know, show the setbacks, etc. I think a plan of a floor plan would be helpful. I don't know if it has to
be. I think we can draw
all floors, but I would sit down with staff and Public Works, and so then with that, so you would like us to continue then?
Yeah, I think so. Yes.
And so. I think that that's consensus of our commission too, is to continue then. So motion to continue, I guess.
All right.
And then how much time do you think you'll need to, a lot of times we'll do it for the next month, but the problem is that you really don't have a month because we have to republish, you have to give drawings and everything else. So do we want to say a date certain in 2 months, or do we want to leave it open? Patrick has some opinion about this, I think.
Well, if we can continue, we don't need to republish.
Okay.
So long as we do it to a date certain. 30 days might be kind of tight if he's going to pursue with the village trying to vacate the right-of-way.
That's my feeling, too.
So,
having been through that
you
process.
You may want to do it more to, like,
be June 8th.
Yeah. Okay. Is that okay?
That's fine. Give us enough time.
Thank you.
All right. So
it'd be June 8th.
June 8th. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. I will make a motion to continue petition PZ170011 to a date certain of June 8th, 2017.
Motion, is there a second?
I'll second that motion.
Second. Questions or comments on the motion? Hearing none, we'll vote. Commissioner Rickel?
Yes.
Commissioner Bello?
Yes.
Jarrett?
Yes.
Perlowski?
Yes.
Gatto?
Yes.
Hassler?
Yes.
Jackson?
Yes.
And I too vote yes. Thank you. Okay. We are supposed to be talking next about a pre-application conference for a five-lot subdivision on Monterey.
Oh, that's what that is.
Jim, and I'm going to apologize that I'm probably not going to get these names right. Jamshid?
Jahidi.
Okay, and Jahidi of Dome Design Build Corporation. That's what I was just going to say. Is this a public hearing?
No.
The answer is no, so you're done. We're not, but you are. Thank you.
Hey, I always carry your stuff out, so I think I'm done too.
So you're done too. All right.
I don't always carry. I offer, though.
Often? All right. So, sir, you're here representing. You don't have to be sworn in. It's not a public hearing.